Hi, I'm Joan Neuberger, and today we're here with Robyn Metcalfe. Hi, Robyn.
Hi.
Robyn is a historian of modern Europe, and she's just finished a book on called Meat, Commerce, and the City of London, about the meat market in the center of London in the 19th century and the efforts to move it out of the city. So let's just start with the market. This is really a modern problem. Before the middle of the 19th century, people just assumed that cities would be smelly and dirty and full of animals. But things changed at the beginning of the 19th century, and we have Dickens talking about the Smithfield Market, which you write about, is nearly ankle deep in filth and reeking cattle bodies. Could you talk about the market and why people suddenly began to want to move it?
Absolutely. It's a fascinating story about just the modernization of cities in general. Mm-hmm. When I first started working on the book, I was interested in food primarily and meat primarily in a historical context, because that's what I study is food history. But as I got ankle deep in it, I discovered that it revealed a much deeper story about cities modernizing in that period in general and in Europe. London was the first city to truly modernize. It was the first city to really industrialize, and so it raised a number of issues, one of which had to do with sanitation.
Mm-hmm. So people began to think that having animals slaughtered right in the middle of the city was unsanitary?
Yeah, well, in fact, there is several things that all converged in this idea of being a modern city that was cited in this argument that took, by the way, 50 years of arguing, which was what drew my attention to the topic in general. Like, how could you possibly be spending 50 years over a market and where it sat? And one of the things was that with the grand migration of people from the countryside into the city for jobs, there was a new understanding of who they were as city dwellers, and they didn't want to really be identified or be reminded of their rural past. Mm-hmm. And by having these animals right under their feet and bumping into them literally on the way to work, they were reminded a lot about this rural, hands-on, earthy, unmodern past that they had. And so that was one of the reasons that they wanted it out of their sight, literally out of their sight, as they moved into this new understanding of being civilized, really.
And you talk about the modern city as being rationalized and utilitarian. What did people mean by that? What was a rational city?
It was really.
What did they want it to be?
Yeah, it was really about usage of space and where things ought to be relative to the city itself, and an understanding, really through this whole industrialization of space and manufacturing, that there were certain spaces that should be used in certain ways, and of course, property values changed enormously throughout that time, and so. What was originally an open, unruly, unconfined, unrational space right outside the walls of London became inside the conceptions of London and needed shaping and understanding in terms of the overall structure of the city of London at this time.
I think it's easy for us to understand why people wanted to move it, because it was smelly and dirty and as you were saying, reminded people of a pre-modern rural past. Why did it take so long? What were some of the reasons that people didn't want to move it? And what was the resistance about?
Well, it's really interesting because it raises a lot of the issues that are actually being contested today in London. Mm-hmm. And it has to do with historical memory, identification with sites who've been there forever and ever. I mean, Smithfield, in addition to being a livestock market, was the place where all the knights jousted. It was a place where all the important hangings were. It's actually the place where wife selling took place. Mm-hmm. So there was a lot of historical memory about this place that people didn't want to change and let go. The other interest was that there were butchers. There was a whole set of practices that had to do with buying and selling food that were situated and anchored in that spot. and the butchers bought live cattle in the market, and then they slaughtered them right next to the market, and their businesses were all situated there, and they were then able to go right next door to the financial center and do their transactions. So there was a network of activities and memory that all were embedded in that land, in that site. So uprooting it took unhinging from historical past and understanding that it was okay in the new free market concepts of the market to let it go.
Mm-hmm. Well, so far we've been talking about the urban history and social memory. What were the political issues at stake? And how did the, what were the political conflicts that kept it from being resolved?
The interesting part about where that market sat as the live cattle market was that it was on land owned by the city with a capital C. Mm-hmm. And London
and
was...
And what was the city?
The city was a square mile right in the middle of London. Next, you could see St. Paul's from the market right there.
And it was a privately owned corporation, right?
Right.
It's still there. It's the financial
sort of
center. Right?
It has sort of a... It does have... a mayor still, and has a guild hall where certain things are still conducted. But at the time, the politics of what to do with it were difficult to navigate, because who really decided what was to happen with that land? You had the city owning it, but you had it feeding the metropolis, what was really being known as the metropolis, which is the extension of London outside that area. So a centralized form of administration and a decision-making body and a regulating body for that entire space just didn't emerge in London until really the latter part of the 19th century. Up until that point, who made the decision? It fell to Parliament, which is really a much larger body of decision making. So there was a lot of public, private, and political vagueness that was still at play at that period of time.
And then in the 1840s, the 1840s were a really rough period in England. There was hunger and also the consequences of so many poor people moving to the city for jobs had begun to erupt into political conflict as workers were calling for the right to vote and so on. How did that play into the conflict over the meat market?
Part of it was that the government, Parliament, was very concerned about social unrest. Mm-hmm. Because they were seeing it with Chartists and other groups who were advocating for the vote and for more rights, and the pressure of the factory system was causing a lot of inequities, the poor houses, etc. So the food supply was well known to be a critical component in social rest, I should say, or unrest. Mm-hmm. And they had seen this all play out in the French Revolution, of course, over the bread prices. Mm-hmm. And remember, Thomas Malthus had just predicted at the end of the last century that the food supply was not going to be able to keep up with the population growth. And so they knew they had this information. They had this agitation going on the ground. And they knew the connection between food and social peace and security was embedded in that relationship. And they didn't know if the food supply was going to be able to keep up. Was Malthus right or not? Mm-hmm. And so that in some ways put the brakes on any dramatic removal at that point, because they didn't want to upset that relationship. It was working. If people were getting fed throughout this. But to add that to the social unrest during that period of time was one of the things that delayed one of the concerns that delayed the removal of the market.
And then what finally changed? Were there sudden catalysts? Were there sudden events that changed opinions and allowed the market to be moved? Or was it the accumulation of all of these things?
It was really the accumulation, in the sense that the economy could be managed on a more free market platform and less regulation. And Robert Peel had lifted the tariffs in the 1840s, allowing an infusion of livestock and other foodstuffs to come into London, easing up some of those concerns about access to food. Mm-hmm. And I think that, along with the fact that they had so many people drumming in and out of Parliament by that time, testifying one way or the other about the market, that they really felt that they could remove it. But timing is everything, as you suggest with this question, because in the 1830s, another individual had actually set up a market to compete with Smithfield that didn't take root.
And that was in Islington where the market eventually was moved, right? And what did he do that didn't work? What did he do? Why didn't that work? That was a really...
It's a great question.
It's a great historical example of how timing is everything.
Right. And in fact, it's not that clear, except that here was a private individual who was trying to... who set up this market, and by the way, used all the latest technology. Mm-hmm. In fact, it was in many ways what the new market in 1855 looked like. So there was no reason for it to be unacceptable from the way it looked. And it was in Islington where it ended up. But people were wary of a private individual mm-hmm. profiting from feeding the public, that the self-interest of this one gentleman might override the interest of the public provisioning. Mm-hmm. So he set it up and opened the doors, and no one came. I mean, a few came, but not enough came. And also, the market operated on the fact that there needed to be one market, not multiple markets. Mm-hmm.
Well, now, when the market was moved in 1855, what was actually moved? And what something remained, right?
Right.
What was removed and what stayed?
So what happened is that, remember, this was a live cattle market, so this was not selling meat,
right?
I mean,
there were
was
cows
meat
being
on the
walked through the city to the market,
exactly.
Bought and sold and slaughtered.
Drovers were running animals through into the north through Islington, usually Sunday night, because Monday was the biggest livestock day. Mm-hmm. And so when the market closed in 1855 for the last time, the animals moved, the live cattle market moved to Islington. And in its place, not after quite a few years of hemming and hawing about what to do with that space, finally, in 1868, they opened up what the British lovingly call the dead meat market. And it's a beautiful Victorian building, which is still in operation today, that sells meat that has been butchered and cut and ready to go. It's a wholesale market.
Mm-hmm. And you were saying before we started that there's controversy over that market now, right?
Right. It's interesting. Many of the arguments are still there, and many of them are still being discussed as mm-hmm. this amazingly appreciated, for its historical reasons, space right in the center of London. You can imagine what the property or the land costs are now for that space. Mm-hmm. And you still have this big market, which in the late hours of the night and early morning hours is congested with trucks all hauling meat into the market, that this is still a contested space. So the discussions about removing it are still at play, about developing it are still at play, and the building conservation nonprofits that are in London are always pushing against it. So there was one big move to move it in 2008. This recent one just started in October of this year, just a month ago. And there's a developer wanting to take part of those buildings and make it into office space. So it will be interesting to see how long it holds out. It's mm-hmm. still a very contested space.
Yeah, it's a really interesting conglomeration of historical issues, the need to rationalize space, the cost of the land, and our desire to, as modern people, to not really see where our food comes from in cities. And that, of course, is changing too.
Right.
Well, Robyn, thank you very much.
Thank you.